Good morning, everyone. My name is Todd Cochran, and you're listening to or watching Saturday Morning Tech with Rob Greenlee on the bottom and Jeffrey Powers up on top. Good morning, guys. How are you?
Doing fantastic.
Well, we're here on a 4th of July weekend. Do you have anything special planned for the 4th?
Just taking some time off and relaxing and spending some time with family, and that's about it. Nothing too extravagant.
How about you, Jeffrey? You got any big rock events planned or anything like that?
Nope. I'm just going to work my switch off and get more stuff done. I just I was just noticing I did a post on Twitter to say that this is going on right now, and I noticed that my Twitter friends, people following me, the number is 1776.
That is like uncanny, isn't it? Oh my gosh, that's. You know, you couldn't try any harder to do that. I need it. Was that? I think he set us up here, Rob. I don't know.
I think so.
Well, anyway, got a lot to talk about today, and everyone that's following the show, if you have comments on today's show, definitely email us here at geeknews@gmail.com, or you can call the voicemail hotline at 619-342-7365. I've got the number up there on the stream for you to check out, but feel free to call in and comment about any of the coverage we've got today. It's not going to be able to get in live, but you'll be able to at least put your 2 cents worth in on the show. And of course, there's my email as well. Don't forget, we've got the Robot Underpants show that's going to produce every Monday. There'll be a fresh edition of that out. And then, of course, we've got the Gadget Professor that comes out every Thursday. And then my two primary shows, Geek News Central, on both which is released every Tuesday and Friday morning. So lots of content here at GNC, and you get subscribed to that via the second column of the website. Well, guys, I tell you, the stuff I want to talk about this morning, obviously, is a lot of stuff about Google and what they're doing with Google Plus. And Rob, if you haven't seen it, I guess you're going to get a little bit of a indoc here on what they've been cooking. But so far, you know, I guess, Jeffrey, from before we actually show the interface, what's been your initial thoughts on Google Plus?
So far, so good. I mean, if I had to right now put out what this is like, wow, I'm very dark on that picture, aren't I?
Don't worry, you're good on the stream. You're good. You're good coming out.
Okay, but from what I've seen, if anybody was to actually put it to a social network comparison right now, I would say it's comparable to a friend feed right now, but it's very basic. Of course, we'll find out if Farmville starts to invade Google Plus eventually, but right now it's pretty straightforward, what are you doing type stuff, and putting everybody into a circle.
Yeah, I think someone summed it up. I saw a post this morning in one of the comments. It's basically what they've done here is they've been able to take Twitter, friend feed, what's the photo sharing site most people use at Yahoo?
Flickr.
And yep. Some of those services, and wrap it up into one. And I kind of have to agree with some things that Robert Scoville said, was that I don't think that this is going to be my mom's place to hang out. I think it's going to be more of a techie crowd, and I have no problem with that. I think it's pretty cool. But I think the thing I like about it, at least this, you know, at this point, still the numbers are pretty low. If I look at my circle numbers here and bringing this up, right now I have 192 people in my circles, just people that I've added, 57 who have added me. And then, you know, of course, my Google contact list is about 2,500, but I haven't went after them yet. And so, you know, maybe the volume's low enough, but I've got it broken down into friends, and there's no one there because none of my friends are here. True, you know, like close personal friends. Excuse me, family. I've got acquaintances. I've got some stuff there. People who I'm just following. These are people that are not necessarily friends of mine, but I just want to see what they're saying in the space. people I do business with. And then we've got people that follow my show, fans, and people that are work with the Geek News Central, and then podcasters. I've got PR people in here. I've got a second separate category for them because I know they're going to be in here big time. And then Raw Voice and TPN. So that's how I kind of got my circles broke up, and I'm sure that will adjust over time. But I think the thing I like about this, Rob, and something that is cool is I can filter. So if I only want to see what acquaintances are doing, I click on acquaintances. If I want to see what the people that I'm just kind of watching to see what they're saying, people they're following, and these are people in the space, Steve Garfield, Louis Gray, Michael Dell, Jay Tenenbaum, Christine Lee, you know, some people like that. You know, these are people that, I know a little bit, but maybe I just know them from the web. But still, I like what they have to say and want to follow their commentary. But I think the thing that's kind of cool about this is there's none of this, I'm going to the supermarket to, you know, pick up a pregnancy kit. There's none of these, weird discussions going on so far. It's all pretty useful stuff. And, of course, I can watch the master scene too. But here's the beauty of this thing, Rob. Check this out. If I go over to Gmail and I'm loading my Gmail, I'm over here just, you know, doing the Gmail thing. And something pops up, something new. See this little red bar over here? It says notification. I don't know. Well, you probably can't see it, but it's in the upper right-hand corner. It's basic. Yeah. So all I got to do is click on that, and it says, okay, Jeffrey has mentioned me in a post, and some other people have commented. So if I go over here, and I was actually, Baratunde Thurston was asking about Flash Media stuff, and actually, Leo just commented on Amazon Flash Media. He says, Baratunde asked, the last live streaming program I used was Ustream. Do you still consider it the best? I want to host a live stream of me talking, nothing fancy, but I'd like to have the player display text in the lower third, blah, blah, blah. So I basically went in and said, listen, I'm using Amazon. It doesn't have no ads. It's relatively inexpensive. And then Leo comes in, Todd, do you pay by the bit? How do you much say for 2,000 viewers? Well, if we have 2,000 viewers on here, that'd be great. I don't know what 2,000 costs, but I know that generally the stream when I record it late in the evening is pretty small group. So, you know, I'm paying well under $100 a month, but I'm sure Leo would probably pay $100 a day or something like that. That's probably what his cost would be. But anyway, so, you know, it's just basically you got this conversation you have right here in Gmail. And if I don't want to respond to this now, I'll come back to it later. It shows in the history. So from that standpoint, I'm stoked about this thing. I think it's going to be awesome.
Yeah, so it seems like it's really strong in kind of groups, which Facebook does an okay job with, but it seems like it's really kind of, Google has really gone after that whole groups concept and trying to filter down to people that are most relevant to you in different buckets. And I think that serves a purpose. There's no question about it. I think a lot of people would like to be able to separate out their friends on Facebook more. I don't know. I mean, it looks really intriguing.
So, whoops, let me go back to the right camera here. So, Jesus. I'm having fun with the switching this morning.
We're just flying around.
Yeah, flying in and out. So, Jeffrey, you know, what's been your experience with the streams and stuff so far?
My circles are a little bit different. I'm finding that, to me, the circles are kind of, well, right now they're good, but I have a feeling in a couple of years they'll just get so muddled together that if you have more than 10 people in a circle, it'll be hard to figure out and configure and move around. And I think that's actually a problem as much as it is a help. If you keep it well organized, then I don't think it'll be a problem. But the majority of America doesn't keep things organized like that. That's why this is
perfect for geeks. And I'm not saying I don't think my mom will use this.
Yeah. So the other thing that I noticed is they did the start a hangout. I don't know if you've tried that or not, Todd. But basically, what it is you press the button, you install the software, and you can have like a little chat hangout.
Yeah,
which is something that Facebook is supposed to be implementing next week. I don't know if they're doing that in haste to seeing what Google came out with, but they're definitely behind the ball on that one.
I guess the main thing that is about the circles for me is like I'm gonna dump, you know, people that are, you know, I think, you know, if you look at your friends, Jeffrey, I consider you a friend, but I also consider you a TPN member. So, you know, you would actually fit in a variety of different circles, and same with you, Rob. But, you know, from a organization standpoint, I'm going to lump, you know, who I'm going to lump like family in would be my wife, my kids, cousins, that type of stuff. And that's all I'm going to put in there. And that's going to be a relatively small group, maybe 100. And then we'll have friends, and that would be acquaintances here in Hawaii, people that I grew up with, you know, and people that I have a, you know, I talk to on a non-business or non, you know, I guess podcast way. I think the circles are key. And I think from an organization standpoint, I know that the following section is just going to get slammed. I know there's probably going to be several thousand people in there. And will that be manageable? I don't know. But I think the thing that I like is, you know, if I don't want to look at that stream, you know, if I don't want to follow that, you know, I can change the settings on that, and or I just go into the specific stream I want to look at and follow it, you know, follow that specific stream. So I'm sure as more people get in here, it's going to be good. But I think the key to this thing's success is breaking people out. That's, you know, why do I have 4 Twitter accounts? You know, I've got one that I'm doing. It's kind of a catch-all. One that is kind of semi-public that people know about. But I have some other ones that people have no clue what they are. And they just use those to follow. And, you know, I know the Twitter has these lists per se. But there are people that I want in private Twitter accounts that aren't in a list. I want them to be something I can go to and look, and I can have my cake and eat it too here by having everybody in there. Now people can see that you follow. They don't know which circle you're in. You put them in. And
so this new tool here, so you could create a stream of posts that would be public, right? You know, like Google could pick up an index or Bing or what, you know, or whatever. Plus also have a group of just your friends or just your family, right?
So, yeah. But I think
so you could select. So as you make posts mm-hmm. to this platform, is there like a checkbox that you check that, you know, this post goes out to this right. group and this before yep. you hit send?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. And there's a way, you know, you just, and there's really though on your circles, you, there's really no, at this point, privacy settings. I don't see, you can, you know, you name your circle and you describe it, but I don't think, see, what's kind of cool about this is the circles are just for your management. From the outside world, if my wife is participating in the family section and she makes a post, it's still going to show up in a public stream because she's chosen to make something in the public stream. I think there's also ways to have to just share. Well, you can, if I want to share just something with my family, again, it's in that pull down. You can just send it to the family. You don't have to send it to God and everyone for a better word. So I don't know. We'll have to see. And you know, it ties back to your profile too. You've got your standard Google profile on there. So there I am. And it basically shows who I have in my circle and who has me and my comment stream. And it's, I've got the about page, and the about page is the same thing. It's on Google today. If you do a Google search for me, it'll come up. And then photos from Picasa, and I have no photos in Picasa. I have two. So I'll be putting more in there now. I really haven't found a compelling thing to always send stuff to Flickr, but I could see stuff to send here, you know?
So I'm going to ask the tough question, which is, do we think that people are going to start spending more time with this tool, this Google Plus thing, and less time on Facebook?
Oh. Not my mom.
Yeah. But well, is your mom really that important in this discussion?
No. I don't think so. I know Google doesn't want to hear that. But Jeffrey, what do you think?
I think we got to wait a couple weeks. I mean, once again, we're just seeing the stream. We're not seeing advertising. We're not seeing any silly programs, apps or games come into play. We're not seeing anything other than the raw beginnings of it because it's still in beta.
Yeah.
And once we start seeing the other stuff start coming in, which it will eventually come in, there's no way around it. That's when we'll start seeing if the general public decides, okay, this is what I want to switch to and not be on Facebook anymore.
And I do like that right now they've got this feedback option, and you can see it right here at the bottom of the page. You can send a preview. You can highlight stuff that you don't like. I think one of the things we should say is I'm not interested in games, so I think I should have the option to shut that crap off. I don't want to see any of that discussion about games. Once that makes it into it. So I think if they can make this so you can filter some of that stuff, that'll be good. But yeah, I guess time will tell on how this is going to play out. But
the API hasn't been last time I checked, the API has not been released
right
yet. So we don't have like Twitter feed and TweetDeck and Hootsuite and stuff like that accessing Google Plus yet.
Well, if someone starts submitting their Twitter feed to this thing, I'll kill them. I'll just take them out of my, I'll put them in the block list. And that's one thing they do have is they've got the ability to block. And I do have individuals blocked already that are based on past experience. And I've actually got a stalker in there too. So, so I've got people that I've already blocked. Now, one thing that Scovel said was, hey, you know, you follow me, I have a tendency to create very long comment threads. And one thing that I turned off immediately was one of the email settings that says for every time someone made a comment in a stream, you know, basically in a thread that you're following, you get an email. So I shut that off right away. Now, the ones I start, I still get emails to, but some other ones I just killed because I didn't want to get, you know, buried. And
Facebook has a very interesting way around their email issues. Cause I've actually closed every single email. That's weird. I've closed every single email option in my Facebook and in Google Plus. But with Facebook, if you join a group or somebody joins you to a group, all of a sudden, there's this new area that you have to go into and uncheck the box that says email me for the updates. Or else, then all of a sudden, you start getting these emails saying somebody updated their status on Facebook. And I even have a geekazine@gmail.com is my main Gmail, but it's not my login email for Facebook. That's a different email. So somebody added geekazine@gmail.com to Facebook, and it's emailing me to geekazine@gmail.com. I can't go in and fix it. I cannot go in and turn that off.
I don't get emails from Facebook at all. I set that in the privacy settings to not get any email whatsoever.
It's more in the privacy settings.
Well, I made one master control, and it doesn't send me. I don't get emails from Facebook ever.
Really?
So, yeah.
Because I get them all the time, and I have to go into the group and actually uncheck the box saying, don't send me emails.
Yeah, I get it too. I get emails from Facebook too.
But I don't join very many groups. So
yeah, I find it a little bit helpful at times to get emails. It helps for me to see if there's any activity around, in my area, but I don't know. Yeah, I get a lot of other emails too that I probably shouldn't be getting. I should turn them off.
Well, anyway, that's kind of
it
on Google Plus initially. So it's not overwhelming. It's not got a bunch of stuff, and I think I like it the way it is right now. So we'll see, you know, over time how this thing works out. I'm going to have to pull a curtain down. I forgot to do that before we got started today. So, you know, what does drive me crazy is right now is now I do get notifications on my phone for Twitter. So, you know, I get more spam on that than I get anything else. Well, let's talk about what Facebook did overnight. And, you know, this is kind of funny. Look at this. Look familiar?
Oh, yeah. Oh, I hadn't seen this.
Yeah.
Well, you have to give them credit. Their programmers are working overnight trying to keep up with the competition, aren't they?
Yes, they are. And if I was Google, I'd be pissed. But what can you do? And it's, you know what? I just thought it's a cheap shot. It really is. It's a really cheap shot. And so we'll see if Google responds to this. But inspired Facebook hack. Facebook engineers build Google Plus inspired Facebook hack. So I'm sure this is a plugin or something. So I don't think it's part of the actual Facebook ecosphere yet. But time will tell.
Yeah.
Now, Facebook is talking about next week, they're going to be launching an in-browser video chat. Jeffrey alluded to that in partnership with Skype. So it looks like with the Microsoft Facebook, of course, I think Microsoft owns a stake in Facebook, small stake. I think that probably Microsoft said, hey, we own Skype now, so why don't you integrate it over here on Facebook? So how do you think that's going to do as compared to this Hangout thing? Think it's going to be equal play?
It's going to be interesting. It's definitely kind of a... It could be a way for Skype to pick up a lot of new users. That's definitely what I think could happen with this. But I don't know. I mean, I think there's a much bigger play going on here. But we'll have to see how it plays out.
I think what could end up happening is instead of us using just, you know, these two lines for Skype, I could probably start a Hangout in one of these windows and run a Hangout and just have I could have four or five people up in one monitor. And that would be pretty cool. Now, how's the, when you were in, I haven't been in Hangout and actually used it very long, Jeffrey. How does the bandwidth work out on that?
I did very little on Hangout, so I can't tell you much on the bandwidth, but I can tell you that this might be a good way to get an audience if you're doing a show.
Oh, that's
true. Hang out while I do my show and clap when I need you to clap and laugh when I need you to laugh.
Well, how do you, you know, you have to mute them, so you would have to have some sort of mute control for these guys. You know, because you're not just going to be able to let them. I've run plenty of public events, and if you don't have some sort of way to mute the audio stream coming back from them, you're going to have a kill switch, because there's always one person that's got their mic set up wrong and they're providing feedback, or one person that is, you know, being an idiot like we have had on live events before. So being able to mute and shut people down. So maybe Hangout needs some muting controls, and I don't know if they have that yet.
Or you can invite you can from what I understand is you can take this and tailor it to the way you want. So
you can have a channel, friends,
you know, that you trust, then do it that way.
Well, that's true. So lots of options there, and like I said, you could even do it right here. We could have all kinds of stuff going on. It'd be kind of cool to watch. see how it would work out. Maybe I'll do that next week. See if we can start a little private hangout and let anybody from the TPN circle join the hangout. That'd be kind of a cool way to do a, you know, and then you do the whole show with bringing them in right here, you know, and everyone's discussing right, you know, right in that window. And it wouldn't be a, you know, it wouldn't be like they would be hanging out here on the backside on the monitor.
You could do a power press questions and answers session. You could do a, how to session. You could do a lot of different things.
Huh.
A little round table and stuff like that.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
I've always thought that Skype could potentially be almost like a TriCaster replacement platform. If you really think about it, if the software was, what, you know, was architected to have these fly-ins and things like that, like right. You have, you could conceivably create a software-based TriCaster type of platform where you could do live shows on Facebook and then record those and put them out as an on-demand download or stream or, you know, whatever. I could totally see Skype being moved in that direction. I have no knowledge of whether or not that's going to happen, but it just seems like it could be done. And having this folded into Facebook as a possibility could be really, really powerful for people to build shows right on Facebook.
One thing that we've been talking, Jeffrey and I have been talking, Rob, is that we're streaming on the live site at Tech Podcast right now. And part of that is, in matter of fact, I don't know how that stream's going. We're, those of you that are watching live, someone said about some buffering issues. Make sure you're at live.geeknewscentral.com. One thing that we said is, okay, so how do I go from doing live on TPN and then as soon as I'm done and I shut down this stream? See, here's the thing Leo has big studio. Everyone can come to him. If stuff isn't come to him, I'm sure people ship in the video and then they put it in the play. And it goes on a schedule. So maybe that's the thing, you know, they do a lot of recording on Saturday and then they go back and replay stuff through the week. My challenge has been, I still want to have the live experience for the guys that are spread all the way across the country. So if I'm live and then I want to be able to shut down my stream and then bring the other, you know, basically start the replay of the other stream, how can we do that seamlessly? And we're still trying to figure out how to do that. Especially with the different types of streaming services and everything else, you know, we'd almost have a central control. And Jeffrey and I have been talking about, you know, putting together a central control where there would be a master place to do this. And so I think that's really the only way or the only place that it can be done. And maybe at some point we'll have to have it where there's equipment where we stream into a central location and then that is rerouted back out to the streaming sites. Maybe that's the end solution. I don't know. I'm willing to put the money into it. I just got to make sure it works and it's worthwhile. And the guys been on the team are behind it. So you worked with a lot of streaming stuff. Any ideas?
I don't know. I'm not sure. It's a tough nut to crack. I mean, I think that, you know, the potential of trying to do something different than how we've always made our media and stuff like this, I mean, it's clearly there. It's just doing it, I guess. I'm not sure.
Well, it's, you know, it's the mechanics of making it look good, you know?
Yeah.
And that's part of it. I haven't gotten any other reports of streaming buffering issues. So someone was saying it was buffering at live.geeknewscentral.com. Maybe if you're down with bandwidth isn't very good, we're pushing pretty heavy streams. So that might be part of it too.
There's about a 5-second lag at the most.
Yeah, have you been watching the stream, the download stream?
Yeah, I'm watching. I tried to watch the Ustream feed, but all of a sudden the ads just started popping up. I didn't want any audio ads coming in the way, so I turned it off. But I'm watching whatever you got on, which is the Amazon stuff, right?
Yeah, have you seen any buffering on that today?
Just like I said, about 4 or 5 seconds.
Behind. Oh, it's just lag. The lag is 4 or 5 seconds. Also depends on where you're at too. If that streamer's up in the East Coast, but I haven't had any problems with it in the past. People have been pretty happy with it. Let's talk about Google and preliminary talks by Hulu. any you know, they're in the content acquisition business right now, so this kind of makes sense from where they've been moving forward with YouTube and so forth.
Yeah, it's gonna be really, really fascinating to see how this one plays out, because there could be a couple different companies that could have an interest in Hulu. So it's, you know, I'm sure that, as we saw with other companies, that sometimes the first one that's rumored to be in talks isn't the one that actually buys it. So it's going to be really fascinating to see how this one plays out, because I think this is going to be really key, I think potentially who's going to win this war that's starting to ramp up right now.
Yeah, Jeffrey, any thoughts on Google potentially buying Hulu?
Well, simply put, if Google buys Hulu, then you lose about 50 to 60% of your content. I don't think that NBC will be part of this. I don't think that I don't know if Fox will be part of this. I know that a lot of shows will probably just say, no, we're not going to do this.
I think if they're going to buy it, they're not going to buy it without those content channels coming over. Why would they buy it if they don't? I think that would be a contingency on buying the site. I can't imagine if, you know, you go into the deal, say, hey, we're going to buy you, and then everyone leaves, and you're like, okay, what do you have left? You have nothing. So if I was Google,
the key to this is going to be, whoever buys them needs to have already had pretty extensive distribution deals with that, you know, with all of the networks for this deal to work. I mean, if you look at what Google has there, they may be looking at this as a way to get into some deals that they don't currently have. But if you look at some of the other bigger players out there, a lot of those guys already have deals. So we'll have to see how this one plays out. I mean, I think it's all about, yeah, I mean, Jeff, I totally agree. It's all about the content deals. I mean, if it looks like Hulu is not going to keep their content providers, then there's not a lot of value there. Because from a technology perspective, there's not a lot of value just in the Hulu website. It's really all about the content and the deals behind the content that are going to drive this deal.
Yeah, I just I can't imagine even consider. Go ahead, Jeffrey.
There's another issue, and that's Hulu's CEO Jason Kilar is in the running for Carol Bart's position at Yahoo, because Yahoo's starting to look at changes there because they're not seeing the positive impact in the last 2 years.
Oh, yeah.
that is really interesting, which could mean that Yahoo could be the most likely suitor here. I don't know.
Possible.
Yeah, interesting, yeah. Of course, Yahoo, you know, I hate to say it, I haven't used a Yahoo product in a very long time. I don't go to their site. Why would, believe it or not, I go to Bing more than I go to Yahoo.
Why is that a surprise?
I guess it's not, you know, so.
I'm just kidding.
It's true, though. It's true. I don't go to Yahoo at all.
Wait a minute, if you go to Yahoo, you do go to Bing, don't you?
I don't know. Well, it's Bing. Yeah.
It is Bing, yeah. Yeah, Yahoo and Bing are kind of synonymous.
Tied together, yeah. Well, you don't get the same type of results on Yahoo that you get on Bing, so they've done something, they've tweaked something.
I'm sure there's a little bit of a difference in the algorithm, yeah. So I think that, I think out of all of the players, I think Yahoo probably has the most to gain by going after a Hulu.
So the question is, can they afford it?
Yeah. Or even, an America Online might be another one that might benefit from somebody like that, you know, from a site like that, being that they're headed towards being a content company.
Well, we are going to have the new version of OS 10. Let's move off of Google and Hulu. We'll see what happens. It's just another acquisition out there. OS 10 Lion is due to come on July 14th. And it was interesting. Yesterday I was took a couple of days off of really just anything. I left, didn't do much email or nothing here at the office. And with Angelo having a new baby on the ground, one of our programmers being out on a honeymoon, and my sales gal being on vacation as well. Raw Voice was down to, you know, just minimal number of folks. And matter of fact, I'm going to be watching the tech support stream this weekend because Michael Dell's out for vacation as well. So, you know, the whole team's been out this week. And so I took a couple of days off and just answered important stuff. I went and got had an appointment with my shiatsu guy, and he's been working on me, and he put me through a torture session yesterday. And so, you know, he's a techie, so while he's, you know, pressing on me and I'm screaming and we're talking little tech, and he is so it's kind of
would you call that T&M
tech and masochistic stuff. Yeah, so you know, it's ripping my muscles apart. So I said, what do you think about this new in the cloud stuff? And he's like, oh, and he's a conspiracy guy. Oh, it's just another way for the government to get access to our data. And you know, so he's not a big cloud guy, but he is pretty excited about the $29.95 price tag of the, you know, of the upgrade. And you know, I hate to say it here, but I think Apple has definitely figured out that you know, the operating system is secondary. It's all the other stuff that they keep you locked into. You know, their money machine from iTunes to everything else is, you know, that's where they figured out where the real money's at. It's not in the money's not in the software anymore. So I just, you know, this with this $29.95 upgrade, the question is, how is that going to, you know, how's that going to affect Microsoft's bottom line? And you look at Chrome being free, and you know, it's an interesting time we're in. So can Microsoft afford to, you know, charge the prices that they've charged on upgrades when it comes time to upgrade?
Well, I think that it's all about value, right? And it's all about perception of value. And I think that's going to drive this for a while. I do agree with the concept, though, that the longer something is out, when there's competitors that are offering it for free, you know, I mean, all you really have to do is go back and look in the early days of the .com period you know, in the early days of Netscape, Netscape was actually trying to charge for the browser, right? And then a competitor, Microsoft, in this situation came in with a free browser and basically drove that market down to, you know, where it is today, where everything is free. I think there is a danger of that, is the popularity of those free operating systems get out there. And if they do get the you know, the value that I'm talking about, that there is a danger that that the whole operating system marketplace could be brought down to, you know, where it's all free. But I'm not sure that would necessarily be good for all of us, just because when something is free, there's less of an inclination to improve it and add features and do things that are good for users. So I think we all need to be rather concerned about that if we really think that's going to happen, because I'm not sure that it's good for all of us that software is free unless there's some other way to monetize it that there isn't a clear picture of today, which I guess in Google's particular situation is ad supported. But I just wonder, you know, how long that ad supported model for Google is really going to keep doing well for them. I just have to ask that question. So those, you know, really my main concerns.
But the question is it really the, you know, you look at what Apple's done here, and obviously they're going to have some sort of improvements to the operating system, but yeah. Don't you think that their model has been that they're going to make it up on the other end with purchases and things like that?
Well, yeah, I think if you look at Apple, I think they're a unique situation. But if you're looking at Google, I think that's where the danger is. Now, Apple's got a unique model where they actually make more money, I think, off of the hardware side. So if you're going to have a player that could conceivably get to a free software model, it would totally be Apple. Yeah. But
I want to show you. I want to show you something here.
But the price tag is good.
Yeah.
This.
Hang on a second. MacBook, let me switch
you can
it.
See that?
Let me switch it here. Go ahead.
Now, take a look at this. I'm flipping it around. I don't know if you can see this or not. I'm running Windows on my MacBook Pro.
Yeah, of course.
Yep.
And I apparently am not alone. It's something like 60% of people who own a MacBook Pro have Windows on and use that as the primary system over an Apple, Apple Mac. And I think that's partly because of the programs. I mean, I grew up in Windows land. Yeah. I've lived in Windows land for so long, and then I get this Mac. And it's like I've got programs on the Mac, but I've got more programs on Windows that I need to use. And Windows runs probably 3 times better on my Mac than it does on a Windows machine. So I've had more luck by doing it this way than by going to Apple. Now, am I going to get Lion? Well, most likely, because I do switch over to Mac. When I run Wirecast, I run it through the Mac. When I run other programs, I'm going to run it through the Mac. So I'm going to do the upgrade, but I don't see it, you know, as a 29 or 129 or whatnot. It's what's most useful to me. And I've got Windows 7 on this machine. When Windows 8 comes out, I'll probably put it on this machine or whatever machine I have after that. And if they charge me $200 for it, I'm going to pay $200 for it. I don't have a copy of Ubuntu, a single copy of Ubuntu on this machine or my desktops, because I've always run into extra problems where I have to actually go in and into a editor and actually change properties and fix properties left and right. It's just a main hassle, and I don't see that going into the mainstream. Chromium, a different experience, but I still think that there's a lot of people that won't be able to do half the stuff that they need to do. They'll see this, they'll have it for like 6 months and then move over to an operating system that actually works better.
Mm-hmm. I think Chrome serves a unique purpose, and the more I use it, the more I'm finding where those unique purposes are, and it's definitely going to be a certain crowd. Now, so far as Mac being able to run Windows 7, you know, I've done that on mine as well. This last trip I went on, I did a experiment where I took one PC and I took one Mac, and I used Mac primarily to do my live stream for the show as playing around with Wirecast for the first time. It's about the equal product to VidBlaster. They're not too much difference in them from a performance standpoint. But it is a, you know, I guess it is. It's all about the tools that you need to use and how you're going to use them. I still find myself 95% of the time in a Windows world, just because I can move faster and there's a lot more resources available, a lot more tools that I use on Windows than I ever would probably use on a Mac. And I know Mac people probably think the same thing, those that have been down that road, but there's some stuff that I haven't been able to do in the Mac that I can do in a Windows machine, and vice versa, quite honestly. So they both have their strengths. So
and Mac dropped the ball this last week with Final Cut 10.
I don't know. It's you know, the pro people are complaining. I'm using it, I'm pretty happy with it. I got actually that as a discussion point here a little bit. Rob, you're gonna say something?
Okay.
Yeah, I was just going to say, Jeff, you raise a really fascinating idea, you know, running Windows on a Mac. I think that there would be an opportunity for Apple to sell a lot more hardware if they were running, you know, like a Windows 8 or a Windows 7 and were actively selling that in their distribution system. I think it would be it's a really interesting, I mean, I'm not saying that that's going to happen ever, but I'm just saying it would be from a business perspective for Apple, it would be a really interesting thing for them to do, because they might actually be able to sell a lot more PCs and pick up market share.
That's funny. So just use the, and we lost Jeffrey. He dropped off the stream. So just, you know, sell Apple machines with Windows preloaded on them,
mm-hmm.
with OS 10 as well, or just run Windows only.
Well, you could probably have both of them loaded on there, but you know, it would be, you know, it'd be easy for you to select which one you would want to have it go to default.
Rob, it'll be a cold day in you know where before Apple.
Yeah, it's just an interesting idea. Yeah.
Oh, geez, funny. Well, I don't know what happened to Jeffrey. He completely dropped off there, so hopefully he'll be back. And let's talk just a second about GoDaddy selling itself to an investment firm. They're being reported that GoDaddy is going to sell for $2.2 billion. Wow. And so Parsons is supposedly going to stay on board. And they are going to use a lot of the money to invest. They're going to go cloud and do a bunch of other stuff as well. So I haven't heard anything. Of course, I wouldn't hear anything from my reps about this. But it is kind of interesting that that they're selling. I wonder if Parsons is looking for, you know, to take some cash out of the company.
Yeah.
But $2.25 billion is the selling price.
That's a pretty good number.
Yeah, it's a good number. And they had $1.1 billion in sales for its recent fiscal year, according to this report at dealbook.newyorktimes.com. So we'll see how that goes. I just hope they don't leave as a sponsor for my other shows.
So do you know what share of the company that the CEO has?
I have no idea. You know, it's privately held, so I would assume quite a bit.
Yeah.
And I don't know how he works stock options with, you know, I know some of the main people at the very top when GoDaddy was much smaller, yeah. You know, and you know, it's kind of funny being part of the ecosystem now for 7 years, 6 years, excuse me. Matter of fact, this month is our 6 year anniversary of them being a sponsor on my other shows. And
that's amazing, Todd. I mean, the more I think about that, that's pretty amazing.
It is. You know, yeah. And this would not be, all this stuff would not be here if they had not been a sponsor. You know, you know, what's weird, Rob, is I had my biggest month ever last month.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. So it's not like the earnings have dropped. The earnings have stayed consistent, and we had a huge, if I could do 12 months like last month, I would, it would be a very good year. A very good year. So, it is, you know, it's in your, you know, you just hope that happens, but it's all dependent upon the audience and how much support they do with the product. So time will tell. Hey, let's talk just a little bit about RIM. Boy, oh boy. Are they being beat into irrelevance?
That's a tough one to say what's going to happen to RIM. They're having a lot of leaks and internal struggles and problems right now, and they're losing market share fast. And, you know, it wouldn't surprise me if those guys are going to be up on the auction block pretty soon here too. And it could be sooner than later. But the question that you have to ask is, you know, where's the long-term value? And I think that the long-term value for those guys
is Jeffrey more, Powers and Geekazine.com.
Oh, hang on.
You're leaving a comment for the Geekazine podcast. Please do so at the tone. Otherwise, leave your name, your number, and a brief message. I will get back to you as soon as.
I was trying to call Jeffrey. It went to voicemail. I apologize.
It's all right.
Go ahead.
So, yeah, I think that the kind of longer-term opportunity for what RIM has built is around, you know, corporate customers. And because really, if you think about what a lot of the other kind of mobile companies out there are focused toward, they're all focused more towards the consumer side. And now granted, the business and consumer side are kind of blending together. So really it's kind of a hardware issue somewhat for RIM, and why they've been struggling over the last, you know, few years is that they really haven't evolved their hardware side of their business to keep up with the market. Right. And I think that the software side is, been a little slow for them too. So what they need to do is kind of evolve their platform to be more competitive with the modern operating systems and the modern hardware. And it may be getting to a point where it may be too late for them to go through those cycles to be able to catch up. And if that's the case, then they're going to be acquired by somebody and their technology is going to be absorbed into somebody else's mobile platform. And we'll have to see who that turns out to be. I have no idea what's going to happen to RIM, but something is going to happen to RIM soon, I think.
I like how you preface that very carefully, Rob.
Yes.
So, you know, here's the thing about RIM is that, you know, there was some articles several months ago about how they had laughed at what Apple was doing and said what they were going to do was impossible. And this is the pure case of where truly their words have come back to haunt them. And they are now, because they refuse to innovate and stay abreast, they very well could go by the way of the dinosaurs. So we'll see. We'll see where it goes. I think Jeffrey's trying to come back in here. Go ahead.
Yeah, because I haven't seen any solid kind of, I guess they do have, a slate, a compelling slate. So they are working, trying to make the changes, that they need to make.
Right.
But, the question is, were those the right changes? And I think, and as we all know, the mobile market's just charging forward like crazy.
Yep.
And that's really where the future of computing really is in the mobile side. There's no question.
Well, either Jeffrey's having bandwidth problems, you're on the same connection that he's on, so you're still good. So I don't know what's going on with Skype, but he's having a hard time getting back in.
All right.
Hey, Twitter, supposedly under federal investigation, the FTC said they're actively investigating Twitter and the way it deals with companies building application service for its platform. So I'm not surprised at all here that they have basically went after Twitter for all, Twitter's basically trying to revoke features to its API, but I guess the FTC is not very happy about that. Jeffrey, I see you're back. Awful dark. Oh my God. Let me turn your.
Yeah. I think my PC heard the fact that I mentioned the Mac, Windows works better on a Mac than a PC, and just decided to reboot. I don't know what happened.
Yeah, I guess it didn't like Windows, huh?
Well, famous last words for everything working better, right? Hey, Rob, do you notice a trend here? Every time someone's using a Mac with Skype, what happens? There's always an issue, isn't there? It's like Andy has trouble with audio.
Oh no! This is my PC that I'm on.
Oh, you're So okay. So your PC punished you.
I'm a little concerned because I have a feeling that's usually the indication that says that the power supply is not doing too well.
Well, knock on wood. So hopefully, it's not.
Nixed a bunch of processes, and I'm trying this again. We'll see what happens. So.
All right, cool. So anyway, with Twitter being their FTC. Do you think they're going to come down and hammer?
Well, it's kind of tough to open things up like they opened up to other companies to build third-party software, and then to start closing the doors on all those companies is that was the strength of Twitter, right? It was the whole ecosystem of apps that were surrounding their platform, and it just seems rather anti-competitive or kind of pretty tough business decision to start changing things to shut down that whole ecosystem and put companies out of business. I think they are opening themselves up for some class action and some lawsuits, I think.
Yeah, time will tell on the Twitter front. Basically, Jeffrey, what we're talking about is the FTC starting to investigate Twitter.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. The next thing up I've got on the list is Amazon's has basically told the state of California, of course, Amazon shut down their affiliate system there when the governor signed the law that they had to collect taxes. Now Amazon is telling the state of California that it will not collect sales taxes on purchases made at Amazon.com for purchases made on Amazon. So I thought this was pretty remarkable. Basically the state of California says, well, if they don't, we're going to bill them. We're going to go after them for money. But, Amazon VP said the company does not intend to collect the sales tax that newly passed California legislation requires it to starting tomorrow. He said the state expects Amazon and other online retailers to comply with the law. If they don't, she said, The state that will send them a bill for tax at the end of the quarter. You know, this is even affects us. We got people coming in doing purchases of products and services from California. I don't know how we would ever be able to stay in business to if I had to send every stinking state a, because they don't make it easy. And to pay GET in Hawaii is not easy. If I have to pay every state sales tax, oh my God, the cost of doing business is just going to go.
And you do have that's why Amazon doesn't have it for you guys. Oh. Like you guys in Hawaii, North Carolina, Illinois, now California, and Connecticut are the other states that Amazon affiliates are affected. Well, Overstock also said that they're getting affected by this. But the bottom line with California is you've got your conglomerate of content creators in California, and you can't just turn around and say, no, we can't do affiliates with you because
well,
you know, that,
Hawaii's
that's where they
law,
make a lot of money.
Hawaii's law never passed, so the affiliate program is still on here. The only difference is in California is that even though Amazon killed the affiliate program, if you are a if you live in California and you buy something on Amazon.com, just regular, California is telling Amazon you need to collect sales tax on those sales, and anyone else that's online. So if Rob was living down in California and he picked up a hosting package from us, we would have to technically charge sales tax to the California residents online with this new law. We'd have to detect by IP where you're or by your shipping address or billing address where you live and charge your sales tax and then have to pay that separately. They're out of their minds.
Well, I think we've all known this stuff was coming. I mean, this argument, this issue has been going on for 10 years now, at least. And we'll have to see how it pans out here. But we may see Amazon just get rid of its affiliate program altogether, I think, in the long run. I just don't see it surviving. And really, I think there's also an opportunity, I think, for a third-party company to come up with a solution to your problem there, Todd.
Potentially.
How to pay states for sales tax.
But the U.S. Supreme Court has ruled in 1992 that a business has to have a physical presence in a state in order to be obligated to collect sales tax.
True, but I also think that these states are going to change that law.
Well, but the thing is, you've got a Supreme Court ruling of law of the land. Until the Supreme Court says otherwise, that is the precedent.
That is true. But I can also see that the Supreme Court is pretty pro-business right now, because whether we like it or not, the Supreme Court is now fairly political. So it wouldn't surprise me if the Supreme Court changes that ruling at some point here.
Well, it all depends on who retires when and who gets appointed and who's got control of the appointments. And I think we see the same thing in judicial elections and stuff. You know, look what's going on with judges being millions of dollars being spent on judicial candidates now, which never used to happen.
Yeah. It's
to affect the, you know, they weren't able to legislate through the legislature, so now they're going to legislate from the bench.
I mean, I know this program is not a political talk show, but I think one of the biggest problems that this country has right now is the fact that campaign finance is out of control.
Oh, it's just unbelievable.
I mean, until that gets fixed.
Term limits too, Rob.
Yeah, we're in trouble, you know.
We need to have, like, let them have two terms, and after that, they got to get out. You know, all of them. There's too much. Fire all the whole lot.
The career politician is... I think it's a dinosaur. It needs to be terminated.
I think the majority of Americans think that, but boy, I tell you, to get them to enact legislation to end their own demise will never happen. You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
The only way you can do it is vote those folks out and vote people in that are pro. You know, once they're in, though, they have it. Oh, this is quite the gravy train. You know, they change their tune and they become indoctrinated. And, you know, it relates to when I was still in the Navy, I used to have to travel and be at manufacturer plants where they were doing different types of manufacturing processes and contract control. And I would stay for 2 or 3 weeks, but we basically had an internal rule that you couldn't stay at a specific company for more than about 30 days, because what would happen is you would start to forget that you would change your mindset to be more favorable to the corporate customer than not. So we basically made sure that people got rotated all the time, so that no one was good. So everyone would stay objective. It's just like anything else. You're in a location long enough and you become friendly with folks long enough. And then you're like, oh, that's cool. Yeah, we'll let that slide. And maybe that wasn't necessarily the best decision. So I think what happens is when a politician gets elected, he may have great intentions, but as soon as he hits that front door of Washington, D.C., it's just, I think they just get influenced and they arm twisted beyond belief. And then, you know, this is where these guys always slip and never follow through on what they say they're going to do.
Well, it's really easy to make statements and claims on the campaign trail, right, to get elected, but it's another thing once you really get back there and understand how the politics of the internal politics of Washington, D.C. really works, and that you really can't do those things that you promised on the campaign trail, because you'll get bashed and you'll never get reelected.
Yeah.
And your contributors that are contributing to your campaign won't continue contributing to you if you do certain legislation. I can totally see how it would happen.
And of course, Jeffrey was, you know, right there, front line center of all the crazy enough that was going on in Madison. When you guys were having your hoo-la there, where you're in national news light. So I think it's just going to get more ugly before it gets better. Hey, let's, this is kind of a funny segue here, guys, but this next story, I don't want to talk about the individual because a lot of people think he's a whack job, and some people love this guy. So this can be a real contentious topic, but Glenn Beck left Fox Thursday, and he had a pretty popular 1 hour segment on Fox and was pretty high in the rankings. He had still has a show already, I guess. I've never heard it, but yeah, he is going to launch a website called Glenn Beck TV, GBTV, and they're going to go on the air. Let's see, can I find it? I thought it was linked right there in the article.
That site is already live, and he's already been doing things on that site.
At gbtv.com. So let me go ahead and bring this up in the browser. So what I'm excited about, not necessarily for his, let me turn this off so we don't hear the audio. What I'm excited about this is here you've got Leo doing his thing. You've got Glenn Beck, which is a, you know, I guess you call him a celebrity. Then we have a variety of other, you know, big line people bringing on these internet TV networks. And I'm really curious to see how this network's going to work and the model behind this. It's pay right off the bat, $4.95 a month, $49.95 a year. If you want to be on the premium side, it's $100 a year. And you get access to everything. I don't think you get access to the website. I don't think you get access to the shows unless you pay.
The most interesting thing about this is the fact that this is actually a reverse cord cut.
Right.
Glenn Beck has decided to detach himself from conventional TV, which is great. I love it. It's what we stand for, and that's the greatest thing. Politics seems to be the hot video trend right now. So if you really want to make an impact, you can go into the political channel and and really clean up, especially because of the fact that you can just belittle almost any politician out there, and you get all the little groupies or people that don't like you all of a sudden coming up there, and you've got an instant forum. I could say, you know, Governor Scott Walker from Wisconsin is a total idiot, and I'd have thousands of people that would back me. And I'd have thousands of people, maybe not thousands, but I'd have some people that would say, you don't know what you're talking about. But I could voice my opinion. What other genre lets you do that? I think the only other genre out there is sports.
But the thing, though, is you can be that pundit, but can you make money being a pundit?
That's true.
And, you know, my really what I'm watching here.
Yeah, I think you can. I think there's a lot of. There's a lot of evidence that would say that taking any kind of an extreme position is a business model these days.
Go ahead, Rob.
I mean, really, look at guys like Sean Hannity. Look at guys like Rush Limbaugh.
Yeah.
Look at even, you know, Rachel Maddow. You know, the whole spectrum is there, and also look at you know, Countdown with Keith Olbermann just launched.
Yeah, he's over on some other network now, the HD network.
TV. And so now we're coming into kind of this presidential cycle that's starting to really kick off. And so you're going to see a lot of attention around political talk shows and things. So this is all timed for the presidential cycle. So, I mean, that's why Glenn Beck made the change that he made now, is because now we're starting to come into the time period where everybody's going to be paying attention to the political scene. And Glenn Beck's going to capitalize on that. But also from a bigger picture view of what Glenn Beck is doing here, a lot of those big talk radio guys like the Sean Hannitys and the Bill O'Reillys and those guys, they've been doing online premium stuff for a long time.
Right.
Actually, it's nothing. What Glenn Beck is doing is really not that new. What's different about what Glenn Beck is doing is that he's taking his video show.
Right.
Because most of those guys have just been doing premium radio stuff.
Right.
And that's the big change that's happening there. And I see it as maybe he's kind of like at the cutting edge of, I think, where a lot of these guys are going to wind up going, is this premium content that's a blend between online and maybe some broadcasts. So I think that it's going to be key for these guys to stay and keep their fingers into both sides of it.
Right.
So they can gather the audience that's listening to on the broadcast side, as well as offer more content online, and then slowly shift their audience to the online piece, is kind of where I think this is all going to go.
Now, the thing that, you know, intrigued me about this was first of all, I saw that they were using a TriCaster. So they're using the same technology I'm using. Same exact box I've got sitting right down there. But, you know, they're actually going to have a set that is a set. It is a true, this what they've set up is huge. You know, they've got the nice expensive cameras. They've got the staff. You know, that's a key. They've got a staff of people that are going to be working for him. And so my question is, at $49.95 a year to watch him, or $9.95 to have the premium stuff, is he going to be able to pay for this and the support people, and at the same time, potentially bring in advertisers for this? I don't know. I mean, that's the question I have. Is, you know, of course he's a celebrity, so maybe he's going to get a million people to sign up, and a million people at $99.5 a year. That's a lot of money. So that can pay a lot of salaries.
Yeah. For what it looks like, he needs to offer quite a bit more free content before he can get people to pay. I think that's, if he puts too much of a wall up to his content, he's going to have a hard time getting people into his world.
And I had seen, go ahead.
No, I'm done.
I'd done some searching on Twitter and different places, just basically doing GBTV. And from what I can see in the little intel gathering I did, was that there are going to be some additional hosts. They are going to have some additional programming. He's starting to pick some people, and one guy was a business guy, business marketing guy, and another guy was, so it was. I was kind of looking through, and it was kind of an eclectic mix of people. They're not saying anything on the website about these new shows. So We'll have to see.
He's building a network then.
Yeah, it appears.
Yeah. Well, that would make sense, I think, if you're going to have content, a variety of different content where you can attract different audiences. It's where you can scale. I think that's important.
Now,
I think that,
go ahead.
The time is now for anybody. I mean, you got, well, you can do the website, you can do Roku for, you can get the app mm-hmm. for like $4 a month or something like that. You can, once they start putting on other over the top situations, you'll be able to charge for your channel. And that's what he's seeing. And I disagree with you, Rob. I think that he's got enough clout that the first 3 months he'll have people just lining up in droves and paying the $99 a year.
I don't think Rob disputed that.
I think he is going to pick up audience soon. I totally agree with you, Joe. I mean, but it's just, if he wants to keep growing, because, I mean, he has a loyal following right now, but right. if he wants to keep growing, he needs to reach out and grab new people.
He's got to show up on The Factor and these different shows from time to time and say, hey, I'm still here. And
Okay. I understand now.
You know, it's
the thing that I think that what's going on with Oprah right now, too, is that she's got this network that nobody's paying attention to anymore. And it's because she's not cross-pollinating her efforts to get people to be aware of her and other places that can pull them over to that new network. Plus, she's not really doing that much online. And I think that's a big, big mistake, too.
I think what I'm going to do, because I'm just seeing from a business perspective, I want to see how they're going to execute this. And, you know, you can learn a lot from these, you know, from these big guys, whether or not you agree or don't agree with the politics. It's one thing or another, but it's a matter of just learning about it. So, you know, I'm probably going to pay him $5 just to see how they're going to execute this thing. And I'm, you know, this is September 12th is their first official 2-hour show. I know they're doing some stuff already. But we'll see. I'm gonna keep an eye on it and see where it goes. And I hope he does very well. I hope he gets lots of advertisers, and I hope that they all understand that there is more of us out here. Maybe not with the same caliber of a name as this guy, whether you know like his politics or not. It can be good for all of us in the end. Let's talk about MySpace. $35 million sold to specific media. What a disaster.
I think that the most shocking thing about that was the fact that Justin Timberlake is one of the big investors in that purchase.
So they must have a plan to do something to, you know, it's a good, obviously a good name, but the question is, what are they going to do?
Well, my guess is that, and for those who don't get on my or haven't been on MySpace for the last 2 to 3 years, the reality is MySpace has gone back to the band look. They've gone back to getting music into MySpace, not worrying about the people in their MySpace pages, but the musicians' MySpace page. In fact, if you do a search on any band, any local band or national touring band, the majority of them have MySpace pages, and they even have MySpace pages their main page, which kind of disappoints me a little bit on the music front, but that's their own thing and one thing or another.
That worked out well for them.
What's that?
That worked out well for them.
Oh yeah. for the fact that News Corp sold for such a low price is just shocking. Especially because I think in the next 2 to 3 years, especially since Facebook has never really, their music end has never really took off the way that MySpace did. You put those two puzzle pieces together, and all of a sudden you have a multi-million, even a billion-dollar industry. Because the music industry is a multi-billion-dollar industry.
But no one goes to MySpace no more. That's why they sold for $35 million.
Yeah, but Todd, I think what's really going on here is I think that site's going to be rebranded. So I think it's going to be, I mean, I'm just thinking about it here. If I were them, I would probably get rid of that name and move to a name that's more music focused.
Yeah.
Jeff, what do you think? Do you think that would be a smart thing for them to do?
I think if they went from MySpace to My Band, that would be probably it's not the best idea just off the top of my head, but
sure.
that would all of a sudden change the feel and look of the whole site.
Well, and also kind of moves them away from that perception of death, right?
But they gotta come up with something that would be catchy and say, hey, this is where we're going. Now, I could be totally wrong. Maybe they'll open it up to try and get the social network aspect of it from everybody again, try and get people back into it. But I don't see that happening.
Yeah,
I think that would be a
Me
very
neither.
Big uphill battle.
Yeah, I think that the band angle and the music angle is probably the best angle that they can go after right now. And just the fact that Justin Timberlake is an investor in it tells me that that's the direction they're going.
Well, and the bigger thing is this company does advertising. So they've got close partnerships with all these companies like, you know, Pepsi and Coke and Ford and maybe Chevy. And I'm trying to be as neutral as possible. And a lot of these companies that are more tuned towards a music end of things, and they'll advertise in a music space. So maybe that's the name of the site, Music Space, instead of MySpace.
Yeah. No, I think that actually would work. Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree with you.
If they can buy the domain.
Yeah, exactly.
Good
Somebody
luck
get
them.
Up on GoDaddy now.
Yeah. I've been trying to buy a specific domain for the last month and offered enough money and still haven't got a response. So it's not always easy to buy domains. Hey, let's talk about CDNs and Amazon. This past week, Amazon announced new rate structure for their new CloudFront service. And this is amazing. AWS has lowered its pricing again, basically no inbound data transfer fees. And lower outbound data transfer all services. Now, I use a different company for a CDN, but we do use Amazon for EC2 and a bunch of for storage and so forth. But this just blew me away. Now, if you are small and you are moving traffic up to 10 gigs, previous cost was 15 cents a gig. Now it's 12 cents. If you move more than 40 terabytes, if you're moving more than 40 terabytes, that's in other words, 10.1 terabytes and above, it goes down to 9 cents. This is pretty remarkable pricing, guys. From what Amazon is doing here, they've also lowered the data transfer prices out of the U.S. or out of the European hubs as well. But this is big, and I got a notification in the email. So, hey, congratulations, your price is going to go down. We figured that their changeover, and just from a raw voice standpoint, it's going to lower my bill about 25% just in this one announcement alone. And bandwidth and that stuff is not cheap. So I'm almost at the point where I can go, well, I'll be careful here. CDNs are going to have to really continue to watch what Amazon's doing because for a new company that's starting up, they generally cannot negotiate CDN rates cheaper than what's currently available on Amazon. We've got some history with our CDN and we've got some pretty aggressive pricing. But if Amazon keeps this up and does many more lowering of tiers, they're already competing in a big way with the major CDN companies of the in the United States. So I know the CDN CEOs had to have got up and cried the other Thursday morning when these new pricings came out because it's definitely going to affect their business. Any thoughts? Can you think about that, Rob? 9 cents, you know, or even 12 cents
a
gig.
It's driving the market back down again, you know. It's like we were talking about earlier. It's, you know, the as those guys scale, right, they're going to continue to get bandwidth cheaper and cheaper, so they're just passing it on. It's really an aggressive strategy that Amazon's taking on this.
And they've also...
And who knows?
Go ahead.
They'll win.
So, you know, I'm
no,
running...
I just think that...
Go ahead.
I just think they're going to capture market share. They're going to get more and more users. I mean, they've got you using it already.
And I use CloudFront for this, you know, for this show streaming right now. I'm paying on a per gig price. So, you know, I effectively, you know, went from 15 cents to 12 cents a gig right here in the first, you know, right today. I'm paying 3 cents less a gig. And it may not sound like a lot, but you do the math over, you know, do 10 terabytes and figure out the difference. It's huge. It's a huge difference.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I guess it's, yeah, it's huge. But anyway, we'll see where this goes. But I know a lot of people don't have to worry about this. They, you know, they don't have to follow this pricing stuff. But for me, I was like, yahoo! Okay, let's talk about Final Cut Pro. And we're going to have to make this the last one because I got some kids to pick up at 8 a.m. at a camp out that they're at. Apple's been refunding their Pro users for Final Cut Pro 10 and or Final Cut Pro X, however you want to say it. But, you know, I paid for the upgrade. I downloaded it, played with it. And for the most part, or about 95% of the stuff that I do that I use with Final Cut Pro, I think it's a great upgrade. Now, pro users who do multi-camera stuff, they're not happy. They do have some issues, and Apple's addressed that. But it shows me that Apple really doesn't care about the pro community that much, and they are at this point more focused on making sure that Rob and Jeffrey and I upgrade to Final Cut Pro instead of using whatever that other piece of junk video editor they had in OS X. So while some people think they really missed the mark here, I think they're going after consumers more than the pro market.
Well, the big thing was Final Cut X or Final Cut 10 or whatever you want to call it is a 64-bit operating system.
Right.
Or not operating system, but a program.
Right.
And what I don't know if previous Final Cut was 64-bit or if it was cross-blend or something like that.
It was 32-bit.
But it was 32-bit? Okay. Yeah. So the two biggest problems that the film community has right now is, one, they cannot import their old projects.
Right.
So they can't just they can't just go from old version to new version and then continue on with their projects. They either have to finish their projects and then move to Final Cut 10, or they just have to ditch their project altogether and start in Final Cut 10. There's a lot of good options inside of Final Cut 10 that makes it a decent program, but then there are programs like certain filters and especially those filters that have that were purchased, like Red Giant filters and stuff like that will not convert over to Final Cut 10, and then they're pretty much out. So the pro community simply cannot take their true and trusted stuff over to the new version. That's where the big problem lies. And I kind of agree with them on that. In fact, and Adobe's done the same, is also agreeing with them to the point where they're saying, hey, we're giving you a 50% discount if you want to move over to Adobe Audition or something like that?
Adobe Premiere. So they're doing a 50% discount, and you can absolutely guarantee I'm going to be checking that out. But I at this point, for me, the upgrade was fine. Now, basically, the projects, as far as the projects not being able to be imported, I think that was my biggest disappointment. But you do a render. Oh, my God. Render speeds, unbelievable. So for just from a time-saving standpoint, for me, the upgrade was good. Now, Final Cut is basically, or Apple has basically said they're going to come back and fix a bunch of the stuff, and they're going to make sure that Red's supported, and they'll have some updates. So they're going to get this on, release 2 or 3. But definitely I think the majority of pro guys are probably going to hang out on 32-bit for a while. It's still a great operating system, and you can have both on your Mac at the same time. So that's what I opted to do. The only weird thing I found about the whole install was you bought it from the Apple Store, it downloaded and it installed, and I'm like, where's my copy? where's my copy of this file? And I still, to this day, I have no idea where it downloaded to and where it's, I guess it just installed. So the days of having physical copies of software, used to be, this was an 8 or 9 disk install. I'm like, okay, so where, how do I, restore this if I need to? But one thing it does prevents people from installing it 2 or 3 different computers. So they did an interesting, interesting strategy by Apple on that as well. Have you ever used Final Cut, Rob?
No, I don't. I've never used it.
Yeah, but I think it's interesting that Adobe's coming in and giving a 50% discount to make the switch. I thought that was pretty telling. You know, they see blood in the water is what they do.
Anybody should do. I personally use Sony Vegas when I do all my mixdowns, but I don't do movie mixdowns. I mix down my shows. That's it. You know, when I go out and interview somebody, that's 5-10 minutes. I do it right. And I move on. So, but yeah, it just doesn't make any sense for those movie producers to go to something and part of it might be because of the fact that it's now 64-bit and they don't do any type of bunking or anything like that. But yeah, it's definitely not ready for a pro producer just yet.
Well, we're here at the end of the show, guys. I know, Jeffrey, you got some stuff going on. What do you got going on personally?
Well, I don't know if you've seen, but the logos have changed, and Geekazine's doing a little bit of revamping. The main podcast 3 weeks ago, the Geekazine Weekly podcast, did a complete retool, and now it's called the Geek Smack. And you can find it over at www.thegeeksmack.com. Of course, if you go over to geekazine.com, you can also get to there. The Day in Tech History is still the Day in Tech History, 7 days a week podcast. And, of course, the special media feed. Gosh, I've been just doing videos left and right. We just got done with Tim Westergren from Pandora. Did something at when I went out to Ford. So I got tons of video coming up there. And the 5 tech things you should know. And I think that's, oh, yeah, the OTT is also going to start ramping up a little bit more, which is all your over-the-top television stuff. That's over at geekazine.com.
Hey, Rob, how about you? Anything going on?
Oh, just the normal stuff. You know, I'm out there, you know, with my electric car pushing in and evangelizing as much as I can. Actually, I'm putting together an event here in the Seattle area. You had a Nissan dealer. It's called the Nissan Leaf Day. Here on July 9th, and I'm out, you know, kind of speaking, you know, like I was on the world with BBC talking about the silent noise issue with electric cars. So here this past week, so that's about all that's going on with, you know, with me that's outside of the whole kind of Zune stuff, which is my full-time gig.
Well, you're on the BBC list, so you know what that means, don't you?
Yeah.
They'll call you at about 3 o'clock in the morning and they say, Rob, BBC calling. Can you be on the air in 3 minutes? We want to talk about such and such, and you'll have to wake your butt up from a dead sleep. And I'm on BBC quite a bit. And I know when the phone rings in the middle of the night that you better be prepared because you always basically run to the computer and Google what they've talked about. You know, if they're asking me to talk about something. So if they're going to focus you on the Leaf, you're going to be safe. But BBC Asia is always calling me and asking me to be on for 3 minutes. And, you know, it's on some topic and they bust me in, bust me out. So once you're on their list, you'll get repeat calls.
Yeah, so I guess they're working on, it's a big issue in Europe right now that, with the popularity of these electric cars starting to grow, that there's more and more people concerned about these cars being silent and being a danger to pedestrians. And so the BBC and the world had this feature that they did here talking about how there's companies in Europe that want to add almost like ringtones to cars. So, you know, that whole topic about, you know, how the Leaf handled it and how people, you know, over the years have gotten used to the sounds of cars, right? And there's this whole passion around it about, you know, the sound of a race car engine or something like that. And my comment back is that the whole fact that my car is silent is one of the big reasons I bought it.
Right.
So it's like this kind of conflict of culture around the car, which was the whole focus of this whole segment that they did, was how that's going to be sorted out and that a lot of the governments are passing laws that says that these electric cars actually have to have sound. So that's kind of what the focus was.
Anything you can say about what's going on at Zune?
We're just kind of in this cycle right now where we're planning and we're building, and it's just, you know, this time of the year is very much kind of a planning time for what's coming in the future. So that's pretty much what we're heads down on right now. And then we have our plans for things that are happening, you know, here in the fall, like normal. But those are pretty much done. So we're just, you know, we're working on what's beyond that. Right. So that's what's happening there.
Outstanding.
And and we did launch this past week a Zune exclusive podcast from the Smodcast Network called Tell 'Em Steve Dave Overkill, which is it's only on Zune. It's kind of a comedy podcast, but cool. I've been doing a little bit more around exclusive content on the platform. So,
well, let us know how that goes, and I definitely have to check it out. Hey guys, I really need to blast both of you. Thanks for being on. Those of you that have been watching, Jeffrey Powers at geekazine.com. Check him out. Of course, Rob is at Zune, at rob@zune.net. So if you are a podcaster and need to get on the Zune, you can drop Rob an email. And of course, I'm geeknews@gmail.com, or you can follow me at Twitter at geeknews. That's the fastest way to probably reach out to me. Again, you've been watching Saturday Morning Tech Show. I'm going to call it a day. Thanks, guys. Have a great 4th of July. Enjoy the weekend. Have some barbecue and beer on me. I guess, well, think about me when you're having barbecue and beer, not on me, because that means you'll send me a bill.
Yeah, I'll send you a bill, Todd. All right.
All right, everyone. Thanks, Todd. Thanks for hanging out. Take care. We'll see you next time. Aloha.